She is going to have a baby very soon, but I think she's watching on the live stream. She's at Stanford GSB and I'm at Columbia. So this work, it considers matching platforms that enable search and matching. And a priori, in the settings that we are interested in, the search can be in either of the two directions or even both. Okay, now in this kind of context, we want to understand what kinds of equilibria might arise and also what kind of design the platform should adopt. Okay, so I'll try to make that clear in a number of sort of stages, what I mean by that. So the kinds of typically online matching platforms you're interested in, think of these examples, dating, accommodation, or labor. There are agents on both sides of the market. They have heterogeneous preferences on their match partners, which have a significant idiosyncratic component, such that the platform has a hard time directly eliciting these preferences. Okay, so this idiosyncratic component is something that only the agents themselves have the ability to discover, but this requires them to spend screening cost. And because this is an online kind of setting, it could be that I want to screen Gideon, and I can do that on my own without Gideon having to screen me at the same time. So there is the possibility of non-simultaneous screening of potential partners. So these are the key features we wanted to capture. And then we want to ask and answer design questions for the platform. And we're going to have a very sort of simple stylized model and just a couple of design questions that we address in this work. But there's a variety of other questions one could try and ask and answer in a similar framework. Okay, so part of our goal is just to try and lay down the groundwork to be able to study equilibria in these types of settings and ask and answer design questions. Okay, so we will ask, should the platform intervene on which side of the market is able to reach out, and should the platform intervene on hiding quality information? Okay, and you'll see a number of points of some connection with the previous talk in terms of we are going to have a sort of mean field kind of game. There's this hiding quality information, which is a little bit similar, and there's going to be, every agent is going to be solving their own Bellman equation. Okay, so I'm really glad to go after Nikhil with this particular paper. Okay, so here's a few examples of matching platforms. So these are categories as labor markets. Just as an example, heterosexual dating platforms. And these platforms also include, it's not just heterosexual, but I'm going to talk about heterosexual dating just for simplicity, and accommodations. And there's some features of these example marketplaces that these last two columns capture. So who can reach out first? On Upwork, both sides can reach out first. TaskRabbit is also a labor market, but clients have to make the first move. With dating, most dating apps will allow either side to reach out first, but on Bumble, the women have to send the first message. And with Airbnb, they've overturned the old Craigslist type of design, and they say the guests have to reach out first. Okay, early on Craigslist, it could be in either direction. So there are choices, and sometimes these choices are different for platforms which are operating in the same sort of vertical. So it seems like this is something they think about in terms of the design of the platform. And we think it's important, and I'll give you some pointers to evidence that it's actually important, and it's important for match formation and for match quality. Okay, the design of the platform is important. It can affect the user experience. It, by extension, can be important in attracting users. Now, one initial thought one might have is that in the online world, these search frictions are probably much reduced. Do they still have a material impact? And you might suspect they do not, but it turns out that they do. They have a big impact across a range of different kinds of platforms. Okay, so this has been documented in at least a few platforms, including TaskRabbit, Airbnb, and Upwork, which is a labor market. And moreover, Kiara's paper on TaskRabbit actually studies what was the effect of the design of the platform being changed at a certain point in time and finds that even the platform design actually plays a material role in affecting the efficiency of the marketplace performance, and the kinds of outcomes that participants can hope to see. Okay. So this is the motivation for us to study, to set up this model and study the impact of platform design. Okay, so the question is, what is the appropriate design as a function of the primitives of a two-sided matching setting for a platform? Okay, and more broadly, we want to just set up this framework to ask and answer these types of questions. Okay, we are going to use welfare as a prototypical objective, just very much like Nikhil, which is not to say that that's the right thing or the only thing you can actually think about. And in fact, most of the methodology will not depend on the choice of objective. Okay, so as a sort of leading example, I'm going to use heterosexual dating. And my goal is not to capture all the detailed features of this market. This is just a sort of leading example for this talk. Okay, in fact, the paper is written with employers and workers. Okay, so it's meant to not capture exactly any of these markets, but to capture some key features which are present across a number of them. So men have a tough time on these dating platforms. Okay. So there's about 60% or more men on most of these platforms. And in fact, when a man sends a ping to a woman, it's much less likely that the man will get a response as compared to when a woman sends a ping. So on OkCupid, it's been documented that it's 2.5 times less likely for a man to get a response than for a woman. And on Tinder, it's, I think, the ratio is closer to 10 or 15. Yes?
The number of pings that a man sends higher than, if that's true, then like this is going to be true, right?
So I don't have the data on the number of pings, but if a man sends a ping, is less likely to get a response. There is some equilibrium behavior, and it doesn't look too favorable for men. So okay, that's my claim.
Anecdotally, New York is the opposite way. I mean, New York City, right?
I think these stylized facts still hold up on for dating apps in New York.
If it's really like the men are on the short side of the market in the city, then you should see them reversing their policies.
Mm-hmm. I don't think that these features that I'm describing about behavior on these apps change. I don't have data which is New York specific to back that up. Okay? Okay, so my claim was that it's already pretty tough for men. And then Bumble came in a few years back, and they said, we need a feminist dating app. And then they said, we're going to not allow men to reach out first. Okay, so just a question to keep at the back of our minds as I proceed with the talk is, does this make things even harder for men? Okay. It's a design choice. Does it make things even harder for men? Because they had a tough time, and now they can't even reach out first. Okay, so this is a summary of what I'm hoping to tell you today. So our modeling framework is going to have dynamic arrivals and departures. There's going to be strategic agents with heterogeneous preferences on both sides of the market. And there is match values are going to have a significant idiosyncratic component, which is discoverable only by agents themselves, that too by spending a screening cost. But this can be done non-simultaneously, okay, motivated by online platforms. So those are the key features of our model. And we want to ask design questions for the platform. And we're going to focus on those two design levers, okay, forcing one side to propose and hiding quality information. And find that design is actually important. Okay, it's important in selecting between equilibria. And it's in some settings even creates new equilibria that don't exist in the absence of that particular platform intervention. When one side has a tendency to be more selective, and I'll make that more clear soon what I mean by that, the recommendation we come up with is that the platform should make that side actually be the ones to reach out or propose.
So that's what Bumble did.
Great. Okay, so we will come back to Bumble, but it's going to be a little while before I do that. But yes, okay, exactly. And then the second thing that I'm going to claim is, based on our results, is that partially hiding quality information to prevent agents from obsessing over dream matches while ignoring other options can again boost welfare. And in fact, this is going to work even as the screening costs go to zero. Okay, it's going to apply actually to both of these interventions. So that's my last bullet here. Okay, so this is a summary of what I'm going to be trying to tell you. So we have flavors of multiple different literatures in this paper. We are motivated by the search frictions literature to some extent, but we try to have a reasonably good agent level model of the search and matching process, which also accounts for this non-simultaneous screening option, which is typical in online platforms. In studying our micro-founded model, we uncover some externalities, which is reminiscent a little bit of the platform's literature. And then crucially, we capture this feature, which is well captured by the stable matching literature, of detailed individual level preferences over match partners. Okay, this beauty lies in the eye of the beholder feature is captured in our model. Okay, and like I mentioned, again, like Nikhil, we'll be using a mean field kind of equilibrium concept. It's going to be stationary equilibrium. I think that also is very similar to the previous talk. Okay, so I'm going to call the two sides of the market men and women. The women arrive at a rate lambda W, and men arrive at a rate lambda m. Each agent I has a valuation for a potential match partner j on the other side of the market. That is the sum of two terms. And for the first half of the talk, I'm going to give results where only the second term is active. So the second term is the simplest thing you can think of. My I's utility for j is drawn IID uniform 01. And later we'll allow two quality tiers of men, where the top men are going to have also a positive quality term, which shifts up how much women value them. So this is for every pair, agent pair, and it's in fact for every ordered pair. So how much I likes J has nothing to do with how much J likes I. Independent across ordered pairs of agents. Okay, the search and matching process is going to start with a clock ring. So some agent's clock is going to ring. The next slide is dedicated to that. In order to make sure that agents do not build up in the system to infinity, we're going to have a small departure rate. Okay, we're going to send it to zero for the results I show you here. So at that rate, if I'm just hanging out in the market, there's that hazard rate that I'm just going to leave. Okay? If nothing is happening, I'm going to leave anyway at that small rate. If I match, then of course that's going to cause me to leave. That's on the next slide. And the focus is going to be on a monopolistic platform that chooses a design to maximize the overall welfare. But this is in some sense incidental. Okay, you can study other objectives and so on, because our technology basically allows you to characterize equilibria as a function of the platform design. Okay, so now I've promised you the search and matching process. So that's the next slide. And then I'll pause for questions. So let me describe it to you when there are no quality terms. The quality is just a sort of detail. So let's say I'm agent I and my clock rings. So this means I have the chance to ask the platform for a profile of a potential match, okay, a recommendation. If there is somebody on the other side of the market, the platform will give me a uniformly random candidate from the other side. And then I have the choice of screening that profile if I want to, in which case it will cost me C and I'll find out my match utility. Now, whether or not I decide to screen the candidate, I have a choice whether I want to propose to that person or not. If I don't propose, that's the end. Or if I didn't ask for a candidate, that's the end. If I do propose to J, then J again has the choice to screen my profile or not. And in, if they screen, it costs C, and they find out the match value. In either case, whether they screen or not, they can choose to accept or not. If they accept, a match is going to be formed and the two of us will match and leave the market. If anything sort of breaks in this process, right, no candidate, no proposal or no acceptance, there's no match formed and everybody continues as though nothing happened, but any screening costs spent is sunk.
So I don't have to pay the cost to make the proposal or accept the proposal.
Exactly. So in some equilibria, we'll find people actually want to do whatever they have to, but without screening.
Is there a total order on the qualities?
Yes, these are just scalars.
Should be quality at least Q or exactly Q?
So you can say I want, so we are going to have only two qualities in the most complicated model I show you. You can say I want a low quality, but I don't want a high quality. That's an option. And qualities in the basic model are going to be freely revealed. Like for no cost, I know I can ask for a quality. When I get a proposal, I know the quality.
Does an agent know their own quality?
Yes. So what are the components of an agent's strategy now? So an agent has to decide what happens, what does the agent want to do when the clock rings? Okay, am I interested in asking for a candidate? Do I want to screen or do I want to propose without screening? Right? So that's the proposal strategy. I need to decide what to do when I get an incoming proposal. Am I interested or not? And do I want to screen before accepting or not? And the third component is going to be the acceptability threshold. Again, because each agent is going to solve this very simple MDP, this threshold is going to be equal to the continuation value, which is also the ex ante expected utility under that strategy for the agent. Okay, so I'm not going to dwell on this, but we just set up the individual agent's problem in the simplest possible way, such that I want a match or I want to propose if my match utility exceeds my continuation value of just returning to the waiting state. And if not, I want to pass and wait for the next thing. Okay, if my utility is below that threshold, I'm not interested. Yes?
You can commit to one. So when you make a request, you're basically committing to wait for the response. You cannot say yes.
Yes.
So how many platforms have this? Because usually you can just say yes.
No, this is highly stylized, okay? So this is at the limits of tractability as long as we are the ones who are analyzing it. The paper has gone to three digits in the number of pages now, okay? So all this happens instantaneously. Okay, so by default or in the no intervention setting, both sides of the market can propose to each other. And quality information is visible. And we allow, so this is again, this is just meant to be a sort of prototypical setting. So we allow only two very simple interventions. One is prevent a side from proposing. Okay, it's as though you take their opportunity clock and just break it. Okay, you just cannot ask for candidates. Okay, everybody on that side of the market is going to have a broken opportunity clock, and it's roughly analogous to Bumble or request to book on Airbnb, where the guests have to be the ones reaching out. And the other intervention, once we have two quality tiers of men, is going to be to hide the quality information of the quality tier. I mean, hide the quality information of men.
So you say like dating platforms, so what do you mean by that?
So dating platforms don't show you a star rating or anything, right? It's up to you to look at the profile and figure out how much you like that person, which might also tell you something about what their star rating would have been, or more specifically, what their Tinder ELO rating might be in the background. Right? So all of them have stuff, but they're just not revealing it.
So you don't allow people to come back to the platform, and thus you could keep track of them and tailor the recommendations, right? You're assuming that once they form a match, they're happy and they push off.
Yeah. So tailoring and all that, we want to stay away from it. So we are focusing on the idiosyncratic component of the preferences. So the fact that people have some structure to their preferences and platforms can try to uncover that, our model itself is staying away from that, right? Even before you think about whether they'll come back or not. Because these match values are purely idiosyncratic, right? So far. So we don't even want to go there, right? So we are focusing on the search and matching part, and specifically that part which the platform can't figure out on its own. Right? If the platform has a good handle on how much you're going to like a profile, centralized matching is the way to go. You don't even need to enable these recommendations in this search, the decentralized process. Okay, so now the equilibrium concept, and then I'm going to tell you welfare is the objective. Okay, next. So the equilibrium concept is stationary equilibrium, or you could call it, if you want, stationary mean field equilibrium. So what it says is, to have an equilibrium, give me the agent strategies. I'm going to compute the resulting steady state of the system. And then I'm going to verify that the agent strategies are a best response to that particular steady state of the system. And finally, I'm going to check that equilibrium is also evolutionarily stable. Okay, if I nudge the system state slightly, and now people start best responding to the nudged state, will the system come back to where it was supposed to be? Okay, or where it started from? This is important because otherwise there are some implausible mixed equilibria that show up that you would not expect to actually arise. Exactly for this evolutionary reason. Hopenhain was one of the first papers to actually introduce stationary equilibrium. And as a prototypical objective, we're going to look at those two design levers and maximizing the social welfare, okay, or the consumer welfare. Okay, so I'm going to show you results in just a minute, but so that you have a picture of what's going on in the background, we have this continuum of fluid model, and we use the exact law of large numbers. For each claimed equilibrium, we find the corresponding steady state. Make sure it's dynamically stable, make sure that agent strategies are a best response, show evolutionary stability, and then rule out the existence of other equilibria. So all this just to characterize the equilibria in a given setting, and then compare with the first best, identify the inefficiencies, and repeat this process, all this up to here, for every possible platform design, because there's just a few different ones, and find the design which has the largest welfare.
So in all these cases, you have unique equilibria?
No. So we want to characterize all the equilibria in each of those settings. The very first setting is going to have multiple equilibria.
How did this compare with first best?
I'll define it. So it's basically, the first best is going to be where you as the planner are going to decide the strategies of every agent. Meaning, do they propose or not? What do they do with incoming proposals? What threshold do they use, both with outgoing proposals and incoming proposals? And those two can be different. Okay, so some constrained efficient benchmark. Okay, maybe I should call it the second best. So I'm going to start with the simplest setting where there are no qualities on either side of the market. There's just ex ante homogeneous agents. And we're going to find, nevertheless, that design is important. Okay, there's no qualities whatsoever. So uniform 0-1 on both sides. And in fact, the simplest version of this is where there's also equal arrival rates on the two sides of the market. in the first question, which already gives an interesting answer, is what are the equilibria that result? So what we find is, if the screening costs are not super large, in all stable equilibria, there is one side that proposes and the other side waits for incoming proposals. Okay, so there's a spontaneous breaking of symmetry between the two sides of the market in equilibrium, and you have both the symmetric counterpart equilibria existing at the same time. There's three regimes. There's a small C regime, the medium C regime, and large C. So this is C. This is the average welfare. Now, the average welfare can go as high as 1 if the screening cost goes to 0, because everybody can get basically a dream match at the top end of their uniform 0-1 range. And if the screening cost is large, then they can get half by just doing their stuff without screening. This is a uniformly random match. The quality is half, right? And nobody has to leave unmatched, because there's an equal number of equal arrival rates on the two sides. So as the screening cost grows, the average welfare actually decreases from 1 to half. But it goes through these three regimes in terms of the equilibrium itself. Okay. And up to here, all this, one side is proposing, the other side is waiting for incoming proposals. Okay, now this is the moment I'm going to... Yes?
Very high screening costs, then they go back to screening?
For very high screening costs, both sides propose and accept without screening. So they get half.
Sorry, and you're showing in this middle regime, the side that screens is also the one that proposes, or it's...
Just one moment. Okay, I'm going to ask a question first, which is, do you want to be on the side proposing or the side receiving proposals? Suppose you got to choose the equilibrium, right? Which equilibrium would you want, given that you're a man? So why would you want to be the one proposing?
No.
So we learned in deferred acceptance, you reach the man optimum if the men propose. Okay, so Nikhil wants to be with the men proposing. Okay, but that in this setting actually turns out to be the bad side to be on.
Yeah, I want to receive proposals so that I know they're actually interested in me.
Exactly. Okay, so the ones who are proposing face a risk of rejection. They have to incur that screening cost if they want, but then there's a chance they'll incur it, find the person attractive, propose, and then get rejected. Right? But the recipients, they don't face any risk of rejection, so they can also invest more freely in that screening cost, and it does not go waste. Okay? Yes?
So that's the evolution is stability to kill some kind of symmetric mixed equilibrium.
Yes. Yes, and that's because it's not evolutionarily stable, and we don't think it makes sense. Because you just nudge the system, it's going to run away to one extreme or the other. Okay, so now to Nick's question. So I'm on the proposing side, okay, and the screening cost is increasing. At some point, which is relatively early on, I find that it's not worthwhile for me to screen anymore, because there's such a high chance I'll get rejected, I might as well just propose without screening. So in this middle regime, the side proposing is doing so without screening. Whereas once you go all the way up here, then nobody wants to screen.
So
yeah.
In that middle regime, then when you include the screening cost, so those receiving proposals are screening, the proposers are not, it's still the case that the expected utility of the recipients is higher than the proposers.
That's going to be true anyway. It's just a better environment to be in as a recipient, right? It also turns out the best response is to screen. So this is what the recipients are getting. This is the welfare of the recipients, and the blue line is the welfare of the proposers. This thing has dipped to half already at this low level of screening cost. Okay, now will an intervention help in this setup? If I prevent men from proposing, I'll get the symmetric counterpart equilibrium, so the average welfare will be the same, but it'll help the men and it'll hurt the women. Okay, so they'll just switch roles between the purple and the blue line. So I can't improve the average welfare by actually using an intervention. Are we at the first best? Okay, so what does the first best look like where I can pick the acceptability threshold both for proposing and for receiving on both sides? Okay, yes?
There's no cost to proposing, right?
No.
So if we're in this far right regime where there's a high cost and nobody's screening anyway, why wouldn't you have a stable equilibrium where everyone just proposes?
That is the equilibrium, okay? So no one screens and both sides propose and accept without screening.
Okay, I thought you said there was.
That's to the left of this point. Okay, so I want to check if the equilibrium is efficient or not, and it's actually not efficient. The reason is that the recipients, they do not internalize the negative externality they are having on the proposers when they are so selective. Because by being selective, they are also causing the proposers to waste their screening cost. So in the first best, the recipients are actually less selective, and this allows the proposers to be somewhat selective, and it sort of balances things out to get a higher welfare, which is this black line. It's not efficient, and our interventions cannot help you here. It's just that we know it's not efficient. The intervention is acting asymmetrically, right? So it's helping one side at a cost to the other. And you would expect that if I change the setting such that the primitives are asymmetric, the intervention should then help, or possibly could help. Okay, so what I'm going to do is now to have a faster arrivals on one side. Let's say the men arrive faster to the market. Okay, first step, what are the equilibria, right? So one might expect the same equilibria as before. It turns out only a subset survive the moment you have a non-trivial imbalance between the arrival rates. Okay, in our case, the threshold is 1.25. If men arrive at least 25% faster than women, men propose, exclusively men propose in all equilibria, except the large C equilibrium. Okay, the equilibrium equilibria where women propose don't survive because the men are like, you know what, I might not even match. My clock just rang, let me just see what I can get here. Okay, so those equilibria don't survive, and these are actually particularly bad for men because at a pretty low screening cost value, they're facing a risk of rejection from the other side, and they have in addition a chance that they'll just have to leave unmatched just by a counting argument, and you can do the calculation as well. They say, you know what, let me just propose without screening. So this middle regime becomes really large, and the men's welfare is what is dragging down the overall average welfare. Okay, so now what the platform can do is to force the women to propose by blocking, by breaking the opportunity clocks of the men. It says men are not allowed to propose at all. And as a result, this was the inefficiency I was just telling you about. Okay, so the long side really is not able to be selective. And we alleviated by forcing the women to propose, by blocking the men from proposing, and the average welfare goes up. And this is because the men benefit a lot. The women are now proposing. Men don't face a risk of rejection. They can afford to screen even when screening costs are non-trivially large. And women don't suffer much because the men are still accepting most of the incoming proposals. But women get hurt a little bit in our model. In practice, you might argue that, you know what, your model is missing something. The women are actually happier in this world than getting inundated with interest coming in. So it actually might help both sides. And Bumble, for instance, has a better gender balance than other apps, meaning that there are more women relative to other apps on Bumble. So in our model, you can see something like a 10% welfare gain. It's probably even larger. Now, there's another interesting phenomenon, which is that you see this gap between the average welfare of these two equilibria, which coexist for this range of screening costs. This is because it's sort of a side effect of this positive same side externality of long side agents screening. So when men are more selective, it's as though there are more opportunities or proposals from women to go around, and so others can also be more selective, and so on. Okay. You see this little gap.
Okay.
Yes.
I'm trying to understand the collision refinement. So, I mean, you have this infection, but don't you need to commit to a different strategy? Because you have this, the other dynamic running along of the stationary collision at the same time.
So, may I request that we discuss the refinement afterwards? Is that okay? Oh, thank you. Okay, because I don't have too. I think I have like 7 minutes. I would have been showing my 10-minute card a few minutes back. Okay. I don't know where it is. Okay, so. So Gideon anticipated this. Okay, so my punchline at this point was going to be that, you know what, maybe Bumble is actually helping the men by breaking their opportunity clocks. Okay. And in fact, Tinder also experimented with a similar feature. I don't know what was the fate of this eventually. Okay, last year, they were experimenting with a similar feature. Okay, one thing we notice is that as the screening cost tends to zero, there is a gap between the first best and what you can get with intervention. Okay, and in fact, the intervention doesn't help as C tends to zero. Okay, now the next model will have vertical differentiation and you'll be able to at least get some benefit when C tends to zero, even when C tends to zero, though you won't hit the first best even there. Okay, so I'm going to skip this summary of what I've told you so far. Okay, but this was all in the ex-ante homogeneous agents on both sides case, and the main point was the platform can actually help by preventing the long side from proposing. And this actually was creating new equilibria and allowing the long side to be somewhat selective, okay, because they didn't face the risk of rejection anymore. Okay, so now I'm going to add, and I'm going to have two quality tiers of men. I'm going to call them top men and average men. We experimented with the terminology and I think this doesn't offend anybody, but who knows. The paper has top high workers and low workers, okay? So we have a small arrival rate of top men, a larger arrival rate of women, and overall the arrival rate of men is larger than that of women, okay? So there's plenty of average men coming in as well. The top men have a quality term in addition to the uniform 0-1 every time a woman evaluates one of them, and let's say that's half. Okay. So it's uniform from half to 1.5, the assessment of a top man by a woman. So the first question is what is the equilibrium, right? So here is an equilibrium. The women are going to endogenously split into reachers and settlers, okay? Again, these are just names we came up with, but here's what it means, okay? The reachers are only interested in top men. They will ignore incoming proposals from the average men. The settlers, of course, want to match with a top man, but they are okay to at least consider the incoming proposals from average men. About 20% of these reachers are going to leave without matching in this equilibrium. And it's an equilibrium, so it has to be that reachers have the same utility as the settlers. And so the reachers, when they match, they do better. So there's a likelihood they don't match. So they're just kind of hanging out, waiting for their blueprints to show up. And so by the inspection paradox, right, a snapshot of the system has almost all the women who are there being reachers. They're the ones who are hanging out. And as a result, these average men who are making proposals, they know that with the overwhelmingly likely outcome of a particular proposal is that it will not just be rejected, it will be ignored by a reacher. And so they have to propose without screening. So this is a really bad equilibrium, obviously. Okay. These guys are getting a uniformly random partner. They're getting less matches than they could have because a bunch of these women are leaving without matching. And maybe this equilibrium explains what happened to this man who swiped right on 200,000 women on Tinder spent $6,000 on his probably just first dates, and then nothing happened. Okay, this was the end of the summer and no success. Okay, so how can we make it better for people like him? The first thing is something we already talked about, which was to prevent the men from proposing, right? So this will lead to the women proposing, and the equilibrium will still have reachers and settlers, but now the average men are not proposing. They have incoming proposals, so they no longer face a risk of rejection. So they can be somewhat selective. Okay, so they are no longer getting a uniformly random partner. But there's still this problem that there's a fraction of women who are reachers and leaving unmatched. And this is a mass of women who could have, from the planner's perspective, been matching with these average men. So there could have been more matches in the system overall. Okay, and by the way, so far we have not changed the utility of women or top men, but only helped the average men. These guys are still sitting at 1 as C tends to 0. So what are we going to do about this now? Can we somehow prevent these women from leaving without matching? So what we can do is to hide the quality information of men from women. So they can still screen and figure out exactly how much they like the person, but a priori you don't get it for free. You can't just have a filter that I'm not even interested in a candidate who is not an average man. So hide quality information. So now the equilibrium, all the women are basically asking for candidates. Give me recommendations. These recommendations will be uniformly at random from whoever is waiting in the market. So now they all end up matching. Okay, so their utility is still close to 1. For the top men, it's also still close to 1. But now these guys are better off in being able to be selective, and there are not women leaving without matching. So there's more matches happening. Or the match flow rate is actually higher. Okay, so we were able to get a Pareto improvement in the welfare of the different agent tiers, meaning that the top men and the women stayed the same at 1, but we were able to get a pretty significant improvement in the average welfare of the average men. Okay, so the utility of the average men. Via a combination of these two interventions. Okay, each individual one also helps, but the combination is the best. And if we go a little bit outside our design space, you can actually think of a subscription for access to a faster clock. Okay, like the Tinder subscription services. I think it's called Tinder Plus or something like that. Okay, I think I'm out of time. Okay, so I'm gonna skip saying any more about that. Okay, so we got a Pareto improvement in welfare, even as the screening cost goes to 0, by using these interventions. Okay, so this we think it's the tip of the iceberg. There's a lot of other design questions one can try to ask and answer. I was at CMU and Su Hang there. He asked me. He said, "You know what? Your model is not great. I think people have a cost of being rejected. So can we have that in the model?" Certainly, right? And basically, we have this framework. It can be instantiated with more realistic model features for the particular setting that you're trying to study. Maybe it can be taken to data. I'm not claiming it's obvious or easy, but it can probably be done. And one can ask other design questions based on the context at hand. Okay, the chair is annoyed with me, okay? So I'm going to stop. Thank you. So let's just take questions offline, okay? So you guys are free. Yes.